Hello. Hey, welcome everybody. Thanks. Thank you for spending part of your Monday with us. And before I say too much, looks like things are all working well on this end, but can everyone hear okay? See okay? Threw a note in there. If you can't, then you're probably not hearing this, so it doesn't really matter what I say. But this technology we've got kind of had to cobble together some of the best in video players and educational software and all that. And then the sum of that is every once in a while it takes your browser a second or third look at it to be able to synthesize and see what's all going on. So if throughout any of these, if you run into trouble with that, refresh your browser, rejoin the session, and you should be good to go. So I should introduce, I'm Brian. I'm here just outside of Los Angeles, California, where it's about 9 in the morning here. Where's everybody joining us from? These classes are a blast. I see we've got around 50 or so people right now, and it's just pretty neat to be able to stroll over from my desk and talk to people from around the world. All right, Ukraine to lead off. That's exciting. My aunt and uncle spent some time over there in Kharkov years ago, so very cool. Then Vancouver, then Wisconsin. Congrats to the Packers yesterday, Manoj. Bulgaria. I had a guy in a class in London I taught one time from Sofia. It was a great guy. I learned a lot about Bulgaria there. We've got Russia. We've got United Arab Emirates. We've got India. We've got Germany. This is, this is just a lot of fun to be able to talk to people from around the world. So wherever you're joining us from, thank you for doing it. And we've got a pretty good schedule here for you over the course of the week here. Teaming up with Prep Advisor, which has always been a lot of fun to do. We did classes like this maybe 2 years or so ago, and it was really successful. Heard from a lot of people that got really high scores. And Prep Advisor and Veritas Prep got together, put together a pretty good program. We're going to do 3 of these lessons together in this format. Today we're going to kind of do a general introduction to the test, but really how we want you to think about the test. And thanks to everybody that keeps chiming in. We've got Moscow again, we've got Saudi Arabia. This is fun, so keep them coming. Purdue, thinking too much about college football. Peru, Azerbaijan, this is awesome. Thank you guys. Gabon, there is a great daily show line where it was John Oliver traveled to Gabon. I don't know if you saw it. So. Very cool. Thank you, guys. Today we're going to do kind of a general intro, not just to the test, not how many questions are there, how much pace per question. We'll do better than that. We'll talk about what kinds of thought processes and strategies, you know, should you be thinking about as you study, as you get ready for the test. What kind of mistakes can you learn from as you try to build those skills? So we'll do that today. I think Wednesday we're going to do some critical reasoning, and then Friday we'll do data sufficiency. Then there's a video lesson. One of the nice things we've got going here at Veritas Prep is all of our lessons are available in on-demand form, just like, you know, HBO, really any streaming service now. So you'll have access to that you guys can attack with. And then there'll be homework that we'll be sending you through Prep Advisor, and there are forums there where we'll answer some of your homework questions. So if you get stuck on anything, want to start a discussion with your classmates, which is cool that we've got classmates from around the world here, and I'll chime in. We've got some other folks here at Veritas Prep Headquarters. So once you're going through all the homework, attack it in the forums there, and with any questions you have, and we'll be able to clean some of that up and learn by doing. One of the other things that I think is going to be a common theme, I know, will be a common theme through all of these, is we'll learn from mistakes. We're going to go through, for the most part, pretty challenging questions. A lot of the questions that we go through later on today will have, we did start, and if you don't see it, it's that top message to refresh the browser. So if anybody, I don't know if we have any other Veritas staffers in here. It's early on a Monday morning here in California, but if anybody would just tell them, refresh the browser and it should take care of it. Go a little teamwork on that. But anyway, one big theme as we go through all of these here is we're going to throw a lot of statistics at you. We have a lot of these problems we go through come out of our practice tests, and we kind of track right and wrong answers for everybody, and we'll show you not just common mistakes, but why people make them and how to avoid them. So we'll learn a lot by doing, by making mistakes, by going through challenging problems. When you get to the homework, it's not all going to be easy, not all just, you know, success story after success story. Hey, Xenia, thank you for, we've got all over the place in Europe and everywhere. This is great. Hey, thanks, Watch. I'm glad you made it. But like I was saying, well, when you get to the homework, you'll miss some, and so really hit the forums there. If you don't understand why you made a mistake, and we can learn from a lot of mistakes here. The goal is make a lot of mistakes this week so you don't make them on test day, and then we'll move forward from there. So one other formatting note before we get too far into this. We're recording all these too, so I'm not sure where those will end up, but we're recording these, so if you do have any tech trouble in the beginning, you know, just kind of getting synthesized with the new format and everything, there will be recordings to be able to check out. So, and thanks, such an eager crowd and international crowd. This is going to be a blast. So, I want to start by the idea of what is the GMAT. I will introduce the test, and it really is this: it's an entrance exam and not an exit exam. And what that means is they're not testing you on facts you should have learned, right? An exit exam is you took this intro to business economics 201 class in college. And to show that you passed it, they need to give you a final exam. And hey, did you learn all of these different price elasticity and supply and demand curves and what happens when there's taxes? Like basic economics, they need to give you an exit exam. Did you learn everything in this class? If so, cool, we can stamp it, you're done, and you're ready to move on. As an entrance test, this isn't about that. They're not testing you on, did you learn what you were supposed to in college or in high school or anything like that. The skills that they test are there because you have to make the questions about something. I always love when we get to present with some of the folks from GMAC itself, and they'll even say, hey, we have to make the questions about algebra and geometry and grammar because you gotta test them on something. There has to be some substance to the questions, but what we're really interested in is higher order thinking. And so it's not about the skills, it's more about the application. Can you apply some of these core skills to everything else? Hey, Bernice. And so that's what this test is about. And so let me ask you guys this question, just throw them out in the chat. Be honest with me, how many people here have ever passed a test on something you remembered, but if you're being honest, you didn't understand? If there was a follow-up question, you were in trouble. You memorized all the dates, definitions, kind of remember the five or six things your professor loved to say all semester, were able to spit those back. But if somebody really sat you down and said, okay, why is that true? Oh man, that's gonna be tough, right? Nice. Orgo does that to a lot of people. Rihanna, it's probably Vidon is with me. I think I've been there. I had a lot of classes like that. I had a class freshman year of college called Great Books about all the Greek classics. And I think you had to read 15 books in a 12-week semester, and I couldn't get through all of them. But I could pay attention when my instructor had these three catchphrases that he'd come back to. I'm writing those in my blue book exam, loosely connecting them with other sentence structures and hoping for the best when they scan it. So I can get a B plus, but I don't really know. And so it's and kind of to your point, Vinod, it's if you're perfect, everybody's got a class that they remember doing this on. The reason I bring that up is, like we got here, when you look at what is higher order thinking, the GMAT says it's a test of higher order thinking everywhere. On the website, so a lot of times we get to present with the test makers themselves, the people that write the test, and they hammer it over and over again. We're a test of higher order thinking, of critical reasoning, critical thinking, higher order thinking. They use that phrase over and over again. And what higher order thinking is, it actually has an academic definition. It's not just a catchphrase or buzzword to try to make it sound more than it is. Higher order thinking, we use this pyramid ideology here because there's a pyramid they have in academia called Bloom's Taxonomy of Educational Objectives. You don't need to know that for the test, but what it's basically saying is, hey, what do you want somebody to be able to do after you've taught them something? The baseline is remember it, right? And we've all passed tests by just remembering. We didn't really know very much, probably didn't get a whole lot out of that course, but we were able to do that, and that is a skill, but you want to be able to do more than that. Above that is understanding. You can remember it, and you know why it's true, and you really understand a little bit more of it. And then everything above that is what they call higher order thinking, and those are verbs like apply, create, synthesize. It's can you take that information and do something with it? And so when the GMAT says we're a test of higher order thinking, they're saying you're going to have to remember and understand some things, but that's not enough. So if you guys know of a scoring scale, 200, 800, 700 plus is what people really want to see if they're trying to apply to the top, you know, 15, 20 universities in the world. High 600s and you're in the game, you know, and local schools will be maybe 600 to 650, something like that. Up to around 500, it's about remembering. There are a lot of people that just aren't going to remember, aren't going to put in the effort to go back to grade school and remember long division or, you know, dealing with exponents and algebra and some of those things. But above that, they're really separating. We look at our room here, we've got some of the best and brightest people from across the world. We've got like four continents represented right now, people from everywhere spending some of their business day here, work day, you know, with us going through all this. So this is the test. Once you get up to that higher level there, it's not enough to just remember. You need to be able to apply and think critically. And that brings us to this framework we're going to work out of the rest of this week and that we hope you think about with everything that you study from all there. You do need to remember some things. So even though I'm going to spend a lot of time talking about higher order thinking, there's some skills you need to know. And this is really what you need to know is what we'll call skill builder, right? And you've got to know some things. You need to know how to perform long division. You need to know how to calculate square roots. You need to know triangle side ratios for right triangles and what an isosceles triangle is and those kind of things. You just have to know some of that stuff. With exponents, I'm going to use it as an example right now. You need to know that you if you have a to the third times a to the fourth, well, if you multiply the same bases with different exponents, you're going to add those, and so you're going to get a to the 3 plus 4. You just need to know that. There's certain rules you need to know. And my guess is anyone taking their time to seek out a class like this, to seek out some extra preparation, you're going to know that if you're presented with it. We're going to review a lot of those skills here together. If anybody takes a class with us, we've got them all in books, and we want you to really practice with them because it's so much muscle memory and those kinds of things. Thanks, Matt. I appreciate it. Somebody who's been there before knows how to push through. So there are some things you need to know. But that's not enough. And the next level we want you to think about is what do you need to do? Because that tends to be pretty tricky for a lot of people. You know all these rules. I've seen a lot of students who they can recite every exponent rule back and forth. Same base, different exponents, you add them. If it's x to the y to the z, you multiply the exponents. If it's x to the negative 1, you take 1 over x. You do all those kinds of things. They know those rules, but they're not sure what to do when a problem gets tricky. Hey, Sandra. So what you want to think about as you study is what action items do I need to take when something's tricky? Right? And so those things are for exponents. One of the reasons I like to lead with that is there are guiding principles for exponents. We've got three of them that we talk about in our algebra lesson. One is find common bases. So you can use a lot of these rules. So if you've got a 10 to an exponent over here and a 2 to an exponent over here, you can't really do anything. They don't talk to each other. But if you break the 10 down into 2 to the something times 5 to the something, and then you've got your 2 here, at least the 2's will talk to each other. And so one is find common bases. Again, focus on action items. What do you do? Well, then what do? You have to find common bases, one. Another one is create multiplication. Again, another action item, another verb is create multiplication. Usually do that by factoring. If you've got something to an exponent plus something to an exponent, you've got a lot of multiplications. 2 to the 5th is 2 times 2 times 2 times 2 times 2. It's a lot of multiplication. That addition doesn't really work with it, and so you have to factor something out so you can create multiplication, turn addition, subtraction into multiplication. And then the last one is, what's that definition of insanity? Is doing the same thing over and over again and expecting different results. Well, with exponents, they're so repetitive. Again, 2 to the 10th is 2 times 2 times 2 times 2. You just keep multiplying 2's. Well, you're going to get very similar results then. And so one of the things you're going to want to do is, when you're seeing that, test small numbers, see if you can find a pattern. And so if you can, then you understand the concept more. And so what the do level is a lot less about what do you need to know. It's, hey, what are my action items? Yeah, I know all the rules. They're testing me on, can I apply them in tricky situations? And so with that in mind, you're going to want to have some action items, find common bases, create multiplication, and test small numbers to find a pattern. So, and these are going, probably, I think they're scheduled for 90 minutes, guys. And so, want to think not just what do you need to know, but what do you need to do, and that's where you're going to find some real success. The road to success is littered with the failures of people that knew every rule, but would see tricky problems and not know what to do with it. And so that's really important. And then another big thing we're going to talk about tonight is, or today, is think like the test maker. And it's a phrase that we've been using this for a while. One time, one of the exam writers themselves walked over to me at an event and came up and said, hey, think like the test maker. How do I think? And I'm like, oh no, oh man, I've been caught. And he goes, oh no, we love think like the test maker. The one question we have is, could you stop saying trap answer over and over again? We're not evil people. We're just trying to test them, and there have to be wrong answers and right answers. That, okay, well, if there's a trap answer for some people, there's a reward for others. Those who are thinking critically get the reward. Those who aren't are falling for the traps. And so, does that work? And they go, yeah, it's pretty much how it goes. And so what we want to talk about here is who's getting rewarded, what thought processes are getting rewarded on questions, which are being trapped, and the test makers are pretty cool with that. If this is what you need to know, this is what you need to do, this is what you need to look out for. And so if you've got some strategies for, hey, in these situations, on these types of questions, they tend to try to get me with this. They tend to reward people who do this, trap those who do that. Those are the kind of things that you want to look out for. And so kind of a complete set of GMAT preparedness. If you're going in to take the test feeling fully prepared, you know everything you need to know, but that's not enough. You also have action items. If it's this type of problem, I'm gonna try one or two of these things because this is what tends to unlock it. And then you also know, hey, before I finish my answer, here are a couple things I need to watch out for just to make sure I don't fall for the easy trap. I'm striving and getting the reward. Cool. So, decent amount of kind of abstraction here. So we need to make it kind of concrete, but we'll attack from there. And I probably should have had one of our staffers here just tell people to refresh. I'll get a new note in there next time I get a chance to step off. So why don't we make this a little bit more concrete with starting to see, okay, so it's a reasoning test, it's a critical thinking test. How do these questions start to look? And so let me throw this out at you guys. First of all, offhand, does anybody know square root of 157,609? Anybody just, oh yeah, I know that. That's easy enough. Some may. There's some brilliant people out there, chess masters, Kasparov and Bobby Fischer and those guys, they'll probably know that. They've just memorized everything they've ever seen. Does everybody know you cannot use a calculator on the test? You can't just plug this into Microsoft Excel and say, oh yeah, of course, I know what it is. So we need to think through a little bit. Awesome. Peter, tell me why. Here's where it's reasoning based. We need to think our way through it. I like what Peter did. He got rid of B and C. Right. Anybody do the same kind of first step there? And if you know the answer, hang on. Let's talk about how to get it. Cool. So the unit's digit is 9, right? And if you take any of these numbers, say we were to take B and square it, well, we don't know what it is, and we don't want to do three-digit by three-digit multiplication because it's just going to take a lot of time, and we have about, on average, 2 minutes per question. But if we were to do that, 378 times 378, well, the first step is 8 times 8 is 64, so you'll carry from there. Then you'll do all the 8s here. Then you put a 0 placeholder and do the 7 digits, and from there, we know when we add all this up, the last digit will be a 4. And so, looks boring. That's why you want to avoid the map, actually. So if you, it's not going to work on tablets. You guys should have gotten an email with all the rules, so I'm just going to ignore tech stuff if that's cool. So those who are with me, let's learn. So we know that this is going to end in a 4. Same thing with C. If you square 392, first step you do is 2 times 2 is going to end in a 4. And so we know that these cannot possibly be right because they don't meet the qualifications. In order to square to 157,609, you at least need final digits, units digits, that will multiply to that last number. And so if we don't have that, we can confidently avoid, eliminate it. So these two are done. And now others, okay, if we look at these others, 323, you square 3, you get 9. 397 is a little bit tricky. Okay, perfect. We're gonna talk about the next portion here. If you square 3, you get 9. If you square 7, 7 times 7 is 49. And if you square 3 again, you get 9. So we can't use the units digit anymore. What can we do?
Thanks, Peter. Yeah, to Abdurrahman's question, 397 times 397. 7 times 7 is 49, so you put the 9 there, carry the 4, it still fits. What's interesting there is that they know you're thinking 3 goes to 9, and so they hide that one in there that people won't necessarily think about, right? So all of these are going to end in a 9 now, so we can't use that same method, but I love what Peter's doing here. We don't want to do 397 times 397 or 403 times 403, but we can do, okay, well, the number in between is 400. If we square 400, well, we know that's 160,000. And you can do that one in your head because the only non-zero digit is a 4. You square a 4, you get 16. You square 100, and you end up with 4 zeros. So you put it all together, you get 160,000. All right. So what does that tell you? E's too much. D's pretty darn close if you back it off a little bit. A is pretty far away, right? And so if you look at that, you could say, okay, I'm pretty confident it's D because A would be way too small. Or you could do something like, okay, 323 times 323 is going to be a lot smaller than, say, 350 times 400. And do a quick proof. If you do that, you'll realize that's too small also. So you can do kind of a small, just like, hey, just so I double check, let me eliminate that with 350 times 350 or 350 times 400 or something like that. Get rid of this one, and the only thing it can possibly be is D. All right. So let me pause here first. Everybody on board with that? Everybody see the process we used? We didn't want to do the math. Just gonna take too long and pretty time consuming and error, not time consuming, error prone. The more three digit by three digit multiplication you do, you're in trouble. Actually, I'll take offers. I don't think they'll let me in, but I can fit in a backpack. So I won't eat much the next couple weeks. We'll see what we can do. What you can do in this case, this is what it is about managing resources. And if you kind of look at the title slides here, they'll give you a lot to work with. They're not asking you this to see who can crunch those numbers. They deliberately pick big, weird numbers so that you can't crunch them. You have to rely on things like, one thing is answers are assets. If you look at that and say, okay, I don't want to do this math, anytime you look at the math you're given and think, I don't like that, look at the answers and say, okay, can I get away with something? They call these number properties, whether it's even versus odd or what's the last digit, you can look at those and at least eliminate a couple. You can look at how far spread out are they and say, hey, can I just do some estimates? Or kind of what we did here is a nice strategy is 397 and 403 are too specific. What if I pick numbers in between these numbers and see, does it have to be higher or lower? Play the high-low game. What you're really doing is saying, okay, the straightforward math, not always, but often, is too long, too time-consuming, too error-prone, and they're rewarding those who can think about it in a different way. It's like, does anybody here work in management consulting at all? They have pretty famous job interview questions. If anybody's gotten any of those, you know, they may ask like, how many barber shops are in London, or how many ping pong balls can you fit inside the Louvre, or something like that, where it's just like, no one's ever gonna get the right answer, but they wanna see how you think about it. If you kind of grid it out and you go, okay, well, I know it's divided into, you know, say there are 50 tube stops within the central city, and at each tube stop probably covers 12 blocks, and so, you know, 12 by 12, and if there's, you know, one barbershop every 8 blocks, then you can kind of work it out. They just want to see how your mind works. This is kind of similar to those famous consulting, abstract thinking type problems. That's what they're rewarding, is who sees, okay, I can't do this, but I can do something else. And so keep in mind, a lot of these questions will look daunting at first, and then you'll be able to work your way out in other ways by saying, okay, I can't do that math, but I can play with the answer choices, or, you know, I can't quite get the number here, but I can tell you what it's not, or something like that. So, awesome. Arup, you're in charge, taking leadership. You can write about that in your applications too, about how you built a network of people around the world. And they do have a forum on Prep Advisor you guys can keep in touch on too. And it's a lot depends on the person. Some people, kind of this stuff kind of comes pretty naturally to. Others have to work at it. We're going to continue to work to see where we get. So with practice, doesn't have to be devastating. So couple big takeaways here. Answers are part of the question, like I said, and it's quantitative reasoning. It's about decision making and problem solving a little bit more than that. Actually, a good question. If we come back to the number here, factoring it out, what's tricky is, if you use divisibility rules, it's not going to be divisible by 3, I don't think, right? And so then it makes it hard to factor, right? So it's, it's a good idea, actually. I don't know that I would do it in this case, just because I'm not sure what to factor out. That 9 makes me think, if it's divisible by 3, maybe I can break it apart. But when you add up the digits, 15 here and then 13 here, you get a sum of the digits is 28, so it's not divisible by 3. So it's not divisible by 2, 3, or 5. That's the hard one. Those are the easy ones, so it'd be pretty difficult now. So, anyway, I love the idea. I don't think it'll work in this case, but it's a good way of thinking. Cool. So here's some of the takeaways there, and what actually did I love there is, hey, just think about what other things are out there, right? And there's actually, if you guys want a catchphrase to keep in mind that kind of tacks onto that is, when in doubt, factor it out. If you're not sure, one other thing that's important, you saw there was a square root. I was talking about exponents or a lot of multiplication. One other big thing is, this is a multiplication division test, not addition or subtraction. And so if you think about it that way, you're going to do a lot more multiplying and dividing on this test than addition or subtraction. And so whenever you see yourself in like, I don't know what to do right now, a good thought process, and actually kind of know is, what can I factor out? Now, some other things, answers or assets and other things in there, but keep in mind, I've always found students are pretty successful when they just kind of realize my best tools, particularly with arithmetic here, is I can divide a lot and factor, I can multiply a lot. There's not that much I can do with addition or subtraction, and so I want to try to get myself in that kind of mindset. Cool. So, in terms of organization, we're going to do some problem solving like we just saw. We're also going to do some data sufficiency. I want to give you guys an intro to this, because when we do data sufficiency together as a full lesson on Friday, we're going to make it a tough lesson. We're going to make it really advanced. That's one place where you can go from zero to hero, go from low ability to high ability relatively quickly, if you understand how the game is being played. So I want to show it to you guys today so that by the end of the course, you're ready to go for some advanced strategy where you can save a lot of time, avoid the traps. It's real, think like the test maker type. So let me talk about what these questions look like. What we've got here, so I actually should mention about half of the math section, a little bit less than half, usually 15 of the 37 questions, so more than a third, a little less than a half, RV's data sufficiency. Actually, good point. It's teacher's trick. If I put the statement there, you'll just solve it. So by leaving it blank, everybody has to listen to what I have to say. So it's a little bit of a delusions of grandeur teacher trick. with these questions, the answer choices are always the same, right? So one alone is sufficient, but not two. Two alone is sufficient, but not one. Both together are sufficient, but neither alone. These answer choices are always the same, in the same order. And what they're asking you for is, when do you have enough information? When is the data sufficient to answer this question? And sufficient means exactly one answer. So if you go look at this and you go, X, yeah, it could be 8, 9, or 10. Then you don't have sufficient information because you don't have exactly one answer. But if you go, it's 8 and only 8, then you've got sufficient information. So if we look at statement 1, can we guarantee exactly one answer to what is the value of X if we know it's between 3 and 5? All right, Oleg says no, and I saw you were working on it up above. Edgar says no. Vidad's kind of with me for a second. I go, okay, well, 4, but it could be something else also, right? Could be 4.9 or 3.14, like pi, or 3.000001. They didn't say that it has to be an integer. And so it's not sufficient. And one lesson here is, the more work you have to do, the harder it is to think about non-integers or negative numbers or numbers near infinity. We tend, our minds are kind of just, preordained, I guess, or trained to think about the obvious numbers, right? Ask any kid their favorite number, and it's never pi or negative 3.5 or anything like that. It's counting numbers. It's their birthday or how old they are or their favorite soccer player's jersey number or something like that. It's never 3.18579. And so our minds will go toward integers unless told otherwise. On this test, you need to think, okay, every option is out there. And so here, it's not sufficient because we don't know that it's an integer. All right. So Peter's thinking that's up. So actually, the other thing you can do, process of elimination is big on these. We know statement 1 is not sufficient, so we're done with A, because that statement 1 alone is sufficient. D, each alone, we know one of them's not, so we're done there. Now, Peter was thinking that, okay, now they tell us, we're already done with A and D, now they tell us it's an integer. So is that sufficient now? All right, people are saying no. Peter's fired up about, it's got a little ESP, man. That's those premonitions will help you on this test. If you can see the future, that's good. So let's see if we can figure out how we can all think that way. Now, and a lot of people are saying no. Here, we don't know statement 1 anymore. Look at this. We've got to say statement 2 alone is sufficient. Well, alone, it's not. But it's an easy mistake to make to carry some of that over, particularly if statement 1 were even a little bit more involved. Not that much harder. But if it were, say, 6 is less than 2x is less than 10, with just a little bit of algebra, divide everything by 2 to get to where we were. Oops. 2005, but it's just because you've earned it, because you had to work on it, it's hard to let go of. And so here it's not, we have to look at it on its own. So, you know, it's a good idea, draw a line under your scratch work for statement 1, start fresh for statement 2. The other, so the first mistake we could have made here was assuming that something was an integer. The next one was carrying over information from statement 1 into 2. We're better than that, but if you take them both together, you know that the only integer between 3 and 5 is x equals 4, and so the answer is C. All right. Now, the question that always comes up on this is, okay, how hard of a question was that? And I'm not going to lie to you, that's not that hard. People will miss it, particularly in the fog of war that comes with being in the middle of a difficult test. But there wasn't that much going on. There wasn't actually that much math that had to be done. A lot of people can sniff out the trap there pretty easily. So this is probably a little bit below average difficulty. So if you got this one right, not 200. It's people will miss this one, especially if it's not the only question they see. If anybody has 10 minutes and you get it wrong, that's tough. That doesn't bode well for you. But if you're doing it in a minute and a half quickly on the test and you carry over some information, people will miss it in a test situation. But what I like about it is that it sets up this for us. that there are two ways to get a wrong answer to data sufficiency, and only two of them. And so think about this, because this kind of just sets up a good way to think about how to do well on this test. Well, if you know data sufficiency is its own game, they have two ways to get you. You think you have enough information, but actually you don't. Right? You thought it was sufficient, but it's not. Okay, you're wrong. The other way is you think you don't have enough information, but actually you do. You thought you didn't have enough, but you're wrong. And that's it, because the other ones are you think you have enough and you do, so you're right, or you think you don't have enough and you don't, so you're right. So there's only two ways they can get you to a wrong answer. And what I love about that last question is it gives us the two major ways that you're gonna make that first type of mistake. One is you assume something there, right, that it's positive or that it's an integer or that the triangle kind of looks like a normal triangle or something like that. So one is making assumptions, just the world is the way you see it. And it's pretty amazing how often we all do that, where the more work they make you to do, the more likely it is that you're gonna forget about a big negative number or the fraction between 0 and 1 or something like that. You just don't think about the edge case enough, so you need to think, make sure you're thinking about that. The other one is using part or all of statement one when assessing two. These are two most common mistakes to fall under this category. Right. Now I want to go back. One of the things that makes the previous question we just did, so I'll update it a little bit, easy is there's not much going on. There's not even much to read. But let's look at this. Say they just give us a backstory. X represents the number of kids on a school bus, right? Make you read a little bit more, waste your time, maybe get you distracted a little bit. What's the value of X? Does the answer change? Akshay says A is sufficient. Elizabeth says, call me and I'll give you the answer. A, a lot of people are saying A. Other people emphatically saying no. Here's what's going on here. The other reason I love this question is before it's pretty darn easy. This kind of looks similar, but yeah, as Elizabeth's saying, as Vidon's saying, as Akshay's saying, exactly. Here they're yelling that X is an integer. Here, number of children, they're whispering. This tells you that it's an integer, because you can't have 3.5 children, 4.9 children, etc. So we don't need statement two. If we just say, hey, it's got to be an integer between 3 and 5, statement one itself is sufficient, and it's A. And really, the big lesson here is there are two ways to get it wrong. The other way is you think you don't have enough information, but you actually do. You need to leverage assets. So there are two thought processes that you have in mind to avoid trap answers on this, on these types of questions. To avoid this first trap, you need to play devil's advocate. And what that means is always be asking yourself, hey, is there something weird that would change this one? Would a number near infinity change it? Would a non-integer change it? Would a negative number change it? Would 0 change it? Okay, I drew my triangle like this, but what if it's the most obtuse triangle in the history of triangles with a degree of 179.9? Does that conclusion still hold? If you're always thinking to yourself, okay, the obvious answer is 4. What else could it be? Could it be negative? Could it be a non-integer? Could it be a weird diagram like that? One thing, I don't know if anybody here listens to American hip-hop music, kind of classic 90s hip-hop, but if you guys know the rapper Notorious B.I.G., Biggie Smalls, we always like to say, Biggie Smalls. If you don't have a Biggie beat in your head taking the test, you may be in trouble. Pick the biggest number they'll let you pick. Pick the smallest number they'll let you pick. Awesome. Good to hear. Figure he's pretty universal, so it tends to work pretty well. Think about Biggie Smalls. In this previous problem, between 3 and 5, will they let you use 4.999? The biggest number, what's the biggest number less than 5? It's not 4. What's the smallest number that's bigger than 3? It's not 4. It's 3.000000. Playing devil's advocate means whatever situation they gave you, see what kind of fringe edge cases you can come up with to try to get something other than the obvious answer. And then to avoid the second trap, you want to leverage assets Which means, hey, they gave me a backstory, they gave me a definition, and I didn't use it. Is there any way that would change the answer? Why is it number of children on a school bus? What does that tell me? It's also with equations. If they ever give you, say, A over B equals C. Okay, that's one equation we know, but we can also multiply both sides by B and get A equals B times C. So they gave us one equation, we can leverage that and turn it into another equation, and then maybe even divide by C and say that, okay, an A over C equals B. We'll do that if C is not equal to zero, so you can still divide by it. And so you've got multiple equations out of the one that they gave you. So leveraging assets means fill in everything you know in a diagram, means unpack that backstory. It means if they give you an equation, try to figure out if there are other derivatives of that equation that would also help you. And it means if they ever give you something mathematical that you didn't use, there's a good chance you should have used it. That if you're ever gonna pick answer choice E for data sufficiency, it can't be done, and you didn't use all the stuff they gave you, you're probably wrong. If you pick C, you have to have both of them together, but they gave you a definition in the question stem. This is pretty common, where they give you something as part of the backstory, as part of the question, that actually helps one of the statements to be sufficient, but if you're reading too quickly, you won't know it. And so the thought process is you want to have as you go through data sufficiency problems are, okay, I got my answer, but if I've got a little more time, or it was kind of easy for me, what can I do? Can I play devil's advocate? Is there a weird situation I didn't think about that's allowable? Or is there any information here that I didn't use to its fullest? If you've tested both of those, take 20 seconds to do that, and you still like your answer, pick your answer. But particularly if you get an answer in less than 30 seconds, like a lot of people do on a lot of these, it probably means you haven't played these games hard enough to try to see if there's a better answer out there. That you're kind of falling for an easy trap when someone else is being rewarded for critical thinking. Cool. So with that in mind, kind of internalize all this, you may want to jot down, play devil's advocate, and leverage assets. I want to go through a handful of problems here and give you guys the opportunity to practice with these on some tougher problems. The stuff we're going to do now is going to push into the high 600s, into the 700s, kind of questions you'll see that way. And so let's take a look. I think I've got a cheat sheet here for you. So we're going to do a geometry-based problem. What I'm going to do is run over, put up a timer for a minute and a half in that polling area right below the chat box is open. If you can log your answers there. Here we're dealing with an isosceles triangle. Just because I don't know that everybody's as well versed on geometry as you will be by test day, a little bit of a cheat sheet here. Know that you're not going to get this on test day, so you're responsible for it. But for our purposes here, playing the game, do that. Answer choices are here. I'll throw up 90 seconds, and we'll attack from there. Cool.
All right, so you can see our class's results in the poll down there, and there'll be a little bit of shuffling and jockeying as we get through here. A couple of people had some great comments a little bit further up, and apologize. I always like with these, if everybody gets a fresh look at it without any coaching from classmates or anything, it's just helpful. If somebody's going to make a mistake, I want them to make it and then learn from it. And so, or if the person typing it in makes the mistake, I don't want everybody going down with them. So we've got a lot of diversity of opinion here, and actually I should be able to read it. The camera blocks exactly that portion of the poll. I want to show you, this is from our practice test, and we've probably got more statistics than this now, but when you get a big sample size of people taking it in a test environment, the world likes answer choice C on this one. And the right answer is, a couple people had typed in there, and quite a few people got in the poll, it's E. What I'm more interested in, I just like showing you this to show, hey, people do make mistakes here, and talk about why they make those mistakes, right? And here's what happens, is people look at this one and go, okay, perimeter of isosceles triangle. So I want the sum of the three sides. They look at statement one and they go, I don't know, you can do it with that one alone because it just gives you one side. I do know it's isosceles, so maybe the other side's four, maybe it's not, we're not quite sure. Then they see statement two and they go, 4√2. All right, I see what's going on here. They start to look at, yeah, I get it, I memorized this rule here, that the side ratio in an isosceles right triangle is x√2. And so, oh, I see what's going on, 4 and 4√2. So they look at these together and they go, oh, it's 4 and 4√2, and yep, I can add those up. It's cool with data sufficiency, I don't even need to submit the answer, I just need to know that I can, so I'll save the step, I won't even add them up, I'll pick C and be on my way. Now, what Akshay's saying, what I think Layla's saying, what Peter and Oleg had mentioned earlier on, here's where this is tricky. This isn't necessarily wrong, that is a possible perimeter, but it could also be 4√2 and 4√2. Why can't we just use this rule here? And a few people have said something similar to that. Actually, we can't assume which are similar. We don't know which is the base, I think someone said. So I think we're getting there. Yeah, we don't know that it's a right triangle. Perfect. All right, Elizabeth Kim, excellent. This is for an isosceles right triangle. They just tell us it's an isosceles triangle. All we need here is two sides to match. We don't know which ones. All right? So this is kind of an example. If we go back to the first one we did, x is between 3 and 5, the obvious number is 4. This is kind of a smarter person's version of that, where if you've studied, and it's kind of, we go back to our pyramid of those who only study the knowledge, right? And are like, oh, okay, I've got this. I know I've memorized all these side ratios, all these rules. I'm ready to go. This is the obvious set because it matches that thing you've studied, but you have to play devil's advocate and say, okay, I know it can be this. Am I sure it can't be anything else? Before, in the first one, we assumed integer. Here, we assumed right. And it's just, this is a more sophisticated version of it. They know that you're studying these rules the night before the test and just kind of ready to go, okay, I know all the side ratios, I know everything about triangles, I'm ready to go. So they're going to use that inertia against you. If you get to this point in blue here and feel confident, I'm not mad at you at all. Actually, I would be more concerned if you didn't think of that, because you need to know that rule for the test. You've got to be thinking about it. But if you get to that point, most people that pick C on this one, once they're ready to go on test day, they pick C in like 30, 40 seconds. They don't do a ton of work with it, 30, 40 seconds. What you need to realize is, okay, if I got an answer in 30 or 40 seconds, I might be right. I might be that smart. It might be that easy, but I might be taking the obvious way out. I better play devil's advocate. And so that's where you want to be careful. Here, the other one is, if it's just kind of a knee-jerk, oh, I memorized the rules, so I got it right,
that tends to be correct around the 500 level because they're rewarding, hey, who put in the effort, who studied. If you think you're scoring 650, 700 or so, be a little bit leery. Always play a little bit of devil's advocate because they tend to use a little bit of that inertia against you where you know, if you start any song, if you just start whistling a song in the elevator, kind of singing, and the haters gonna hate, 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 and the players gonna... You're singing Shake It Off right now. If you guys know Biggie, you probably know Taylor Swift too, right? You're singing that because your mind has to complete it. When they give you the symptoms of a rule that you spent a ton of time memorizing, your mind will fill it in. Almost everybody has to do that. And so what do you need to do? You have to have that presence of mind to say, okay, it could be that, could be something else. So I need to play devil's advocate. So the real lesson here is, oops. I don't even know if that's a good abbreviation there. And so make sure that when something comes easily, particularly if it's, oh, I know the rule, you back it off, play a little bit of devil's advocate, and make sure that you know what you're doing. One other thought on this one, not to to over grandstand on any one question, but what always bothers me, it just like makes me sad when I see somebody miss this question in a practice test, you know, or in a homework worksheet set I give them or something like that, and then I see them writing down their kind of error log of, hey, why did I make the mistakes I made? And they write down triangle or geometry, and I gotta go, you didn't get it wrong because you don't know enough about triangles. You got it wrong because you didn't play devil's advocate. And so another thing to think about when you get problems wrong, and you will on practice tests, on homework, wherever, try to ask yourself, why did I get it wrong? Was it because I didn't know the information, or because I jumped for a trap answer a little too quickly, I didn't think critically enough, I didn't test other options or play devil's advocate? Bothers me when people do this, because I'm like, you're gonna spend a half an hour tomorrow night reviewing geometry rules, but you don't need to. You got it wrong probably because you were so fixated on the geometry rules. You knew enough geometry to get it wrong, you just didn't play the game well. And so think about, why did you get it wrong, so that you don't just double down on the stuff you're already good at. Cool. So, nice. I find the ability to think spatially is helpful on these. I did a lot of, it almost looked like I was a mime when I was taking the test, kind of, you know, drawing shapes, 3D shapes with my hands and everything. So the mind is nice. All right. So sometimes, sometimes you get it right for the wrong reason, wrong for the right reason, anything. So keep all those in mind. The big lesson here is play devil's advocate. Let's try one more. We'll attack this one. I'll tell you what Macklemore is doing on this slide. I'm going to do the same thing. Give you guys 90 seconds in a clear poll. If you guys want to attack this one, answer choices are here for you. Let me drag this up so that you guys can see everything. And then we'll attack from here. Cool.
Ryan, thanks everybody for participation. One of the other neat things, if you guys can't type them in the poll or click on your answer in the poll, it's also just cool because at the end I'll broadcast the results so you guys can see. So how you know who's picking which answer, not who's picking, but what percentage of people are picking which answers, all that kind of a thing. Here, the other thing I like is we have worldwide statistics here. So we get to see our stats, get to see the world's stats, and ours were pretty similar. I think we had, if I kind of lean here, apologies for leaning out of the way, is, I always have the questions up on the screen when I walk away, and the answer choices were here. Our group likes C, and the world tends to like C on this, and C has been wrong the last couple times, so I don't think that C is never right. It's just happened to pick a handful of questions where that's true. The right answer is B. People tend to like C, and I'm mostly interested in why, yet again. So one of the reasons we got the thrift shot, this is a dated slide now, because nobody's hearing that song anymore, but it's about leveraging assets, going thrift shopping, bargain hunting, what's undervalued and all that kind of thing. What ends up happening on this one, almost everybody can look at A and say, okay, did one of the workers sell at least 3 shirts? And we've got 4 workers from the international charity. So 4 people selling 8 shirts, did somebody sell at least 3? Now, a couple questions before we even start here, what do shirts tell us? What does the story tell us in this case? Because we've talked about what we can learn from a backstory in data sufficiency. Does anybody think when they go, oh, shirts? Okay, I at least know something. All right, it's got to be, yeah, real number, an integer, right? It's got to be integers is kind of what I would say here, right? So no matter how small a shirt, we got a guy who works here, Jason, wears tiny shirts, almost uncomfortably small shirts for his body type, but it still counts as a shirt. I always like to laugh at him and say, hey, you're wearing 2/3 of a shirt today, but it counts as a shirt. There's no such thing as 2/3 of a shirt, so it's got to be integers. Right away, that's telling me, okay, I bet it's a leverage assets problem. Anytime they define something in a word problem that limits it to integers, and the other one is you can't have -2 shirts, right? So we know we're dealing with integers greater than or equal to 0. Could be 0. You can have no shirts, but at the same time, you can't have -2 shirts, right? And so, awesome. Actually, I like the way you're thinking. We'll all work on that one together. Most people with statement one can go, okay, well, the fairest way to do this, if you have 4 people and 8 shirts, is 2, 2, 2, and 2. So, okay, with that, the answer is no. Nobody sold at least 3. All right. But if you give one of these shirts from the first person, take that away, make this one, now you've got a floating one shirt. You have to give it to this one, or maybe to this one, or maybe to this one. The minute you take away one shirt from one person of the 2, 2, 2, and 2, this is our clear no one did that. Really anything else, take away one from this person, somebody else has to sell it because we still have to add up to 8. So anything else gives us yes, so it's not sufficient, but man, it's close. Is everybody on board with that? I think that's how most people tend to think here. It's close. If they all sell the same, cool, it's even. But otherwise, and they're all 2, otherwise somebody's selling at least 3. All right? So we can get both answers, yes and no. So it's not sufficient, but it's very close. And then, exactly, it can live. That's what I was saying. If you take away this one, this person no longer has 2, it has 1, then somebody, maybe it's this one, has to have 3. So it could absolutely be that. All right. So with that one, exactly. So statement 1 is not sufficient because it could be all 2s, could be 1, 3, 2, and 2, could be one person has 8, the others all have 0. In every other case but 2, 2, 2, and 2, somebody's selling at least 3. So it's not sufficient only because of that initial one of all 2s. Then people look at statement 2 and go, oh, I see. They just ruled out that parity where everybody sells the same. So, okay, that makes it easy to do with both of them. And then they'll look at it for a second and say, and let me know if you guys thought this way, I can't really set up an equation with that. I don't know what to do with statement 2 on its own. It's there, it eliminates the no version up here. So it's C, but it's not that hard. Well, here's where
you want to leverage assets. Because the other thing I'm going to attack, they're asking, did anyone sell at least three shirts? Is at least three, is that a high bar? I don't know if anybody works in sales, and if you came to your boss at the end of the year and said, hey, I sold three, probably get fired, right? Three's not a lot, unless you're selling like space shuttles or something like that, then three's a high number. Shirts, if you work at a shirt store and you sell three in a day, you're going out of business. So at least three's not a high bar. And so you wanna think about, okay, well, first of all you have is statement two, no two workers sold the same, it's easy to get a yes here, right? Because you can say a million, a billion, a trillion, and a thousand. Everybody sold a ton of shirts, right? And so it's easy to get a yes. 10, 20, 30, 40, 5, 6, 7, 8. No two workers sold the same. It's pretty easy to get a yes. So if we want to get a no, we want to go as low as possible because we need to get all these people under three. What's the smallest number of shirts someone can sell? I did sales for a little bit in my life. I was a terrible salesperson. I know from firsthand experience, you can sell nothing, right? Elizabeth, Val, awesome, right? So we can sell zero. So if we've got person A, person B, person C, and person D, and we say, okay, the lowest someone with A can sell is zero, right? With B, if you can't sell zero, what's the next lowest? All right, Elizabeth's getting there. Ronak's getting there, right? And so B, the next lowest you can sell is one. If you have to sell something low, but you can't match zero and one, because you can't have the same, the next lowest number is two, which means the next lowest number, if we have each of these people sell the minimum number they're allowed to, zero, one, two, and three, well, we're guaranteed going as low as we can go, somebody's selling at least three. So we don't need the total number of shirts, right? All we know is this is the smallest we could ever go, and then anything else is bigger than that. We don't know statement one anymore, but we don't need to know it. Even if we go the smallest with four people, not repeating the same number, it's somebody's selling three or more. And so that's why statement two is sufficient. And it's one of those cases where, at first glance, it probably doesn't look sufficient. And it's where thinking about, hey, I need to leverage assets is so important. Yeah, if you look at, this one doesn't add up, Dave. This is the smallest possible. So eight, if we had that, means you have to sell even more. We don't know that anymore. All we know is if no two workers sell the same, and they have to be integers because they're shirts, and they can't be negative, the lowest you can go is zero, one, two, and three. So. And no, you don't, Carlos. Look at this. If we never had heard about this, try to get rid of it as much as possible. No two workers sold the same. This is the lowest you can go. And everything else is above that. So eight shirts doesn't matter because we're looking at, can we solve this question with this single piece of information? And so we can't. Right, so forget, remember we said before, when you're looking at answer choice statement two, forget everything about statement one. I'm trying hard. We don't know anything about it, and we still get that conclusion that 0, 1, 2, and 3 is the lowest you can possibly go. If there were 8, maybe it's 0, 1, 2, and 5, and that would work. Or 1, 2, and I can't do 1, 2. Anyway, you don't need it anymore. It is sufficient. And really the bigger lesson on all this is you gotta leverage assets on these. If you ever get an answer that's obvious, one kind of common blueprint they have on these is they have a statement that doesn't seem like much on the surface, but if you really unpack it and leverage things like at least three is a small bar, shirts have to be integers that are at least, you know, zero or above, well, then you can get somewhere with this one. So the real lesson is try to leverage assets. The other one is think about hints, right? So we talked before about, okay, there's two different strategies, play devil's advocate and leverage assets. Well, why is this a leverage assets problem? It's a leverage assets problem to me because one, C is pretty obvious. You can definitely do with both of them together. I wanna try to do a little bit more, and they give me these clues. Shirts means integers greater than or equal to zero. That low bar there means, I don't know, I think it's kind of hard to sell have many people less than three, if you're doing it that way, kind of thinking, hey, I want to spend some time on statement two, a lot of these strategies just tell you where to spend your time and how to spend it. Cool. So the answer is B. The biggest thing is leverage assets here. The other one I think is interesting here is keep in mind, even for those of you who are really good at math, we've had people work here who are math majors. We've got Jeremy, who was our tech manager for a while, was a math major at UCLA, really smart guy. He hated this question. He's like, but you can't come up with an equation, you can't whatever. And they do a lot of word problems on the GMAT that are trial and error, that are just, it's more of a logic puzzle than a math problem. Here it's more about the logic. People don't who are good at math don't love it because you can't set up an equation. You really have to roll up your sleeves and get your hands dirty a little bit with trial and error. But if you know, hey, it seems like a leverage assets problem, they've given me the clues that it is, then you know to spend some time doing that. So that's in my ears. We've seen a good play devil's advocate with the isosceles triangle. We've seen a good leverage assets. I want to do one more that's kind of just a totally classic problem. This one here, I'll type in the answer choices in just a second so you guys have access to those because I don't have them up here. We'll do the same thing, 90 seconds with an open poll. This one is a total think like the test makers. They use this strategy to really screw with people here. But once you've seen it, we'll talk about some more clues, how to play the game well in about 90 seconds. So fire away. I'll type in the answers into the polls or into the chat so you guys have them, and we'll be good to go. All right, love seeing all the answers in here. It's video's moving, right? Yeah, I can see it moving here, so we're good. We're good. I just walked off to let you guys take a look at all that there. So, going a lot of good rationale for how everybody's thinking here. So thank you guys. The participation's awesome. The more people are commenting and participating in the poll, I think the more you guys get out of it. So appreciate all of that. So Peter's got a good point there. Let me show you guys. You guys have seen our stats. I'm just going to lean here. We really like C as a group here. And you guys aren't alone because here's how the world does. Actually, we got better stats than this now. I've just got to look at all this. This is C. And the right answer is A. And again, I'm just more interested in why. This one's pretty has a pretty common template the way they like to set these up. And I saw some people come up with pretty good rationale for A. Let me ask you guys this. Say, you know, you've been at work, you know, Friday afternoon, it's been a long week, and your roommate texts you or, you know, your girlfriend texts you, somebody just goes, hey, it's been a long week, do you want to get a pizza and watch a movie on Netflix later? Pretty normal question. Kind of hard to say no to that unless you've got other plans or, you know, gluten allergy or something like that.
If they instead say, hey, it's been a long week, do you want to get a mushroom, anchovies, an extra cheese pizza from Domino's, because I have Domino's, and watch a critically acclaimed drama featuring a strong female lead on Netflix? That's a weird question. And it's weird because it's overly specific. Well, here's a clue when you see overly specific questions in data sufficiency form on the GMAT. They tend to lend themselves well to leverage assets. Because what is X is a normal. It's, hey, you want to get a pizza and watch a movie. That's normal. What is the sum of the perimeters of the two triangles is overly specific. And what almost always happens when they ask you, what is the product AB? What is the sum X plus Y plus Z? What is the sum of the perimeters? When they ask you for a weird output, almost always you can get that output exactly without getting all the individual lengths there. Right? And so here, what everybody wants to do is be able to fill in absolutely everything. But if you think about what is the sum of the perimeters, well, if we've got equilateral means, if we unpack that, that means that these three sides are equal and these three sides are equal. And so if you call these, say, X, X, and X, and these Y, Y, and Y, the sum of the perimeters, and the reason we're doing all this is, hey, it's kind of a leverage asset. I want to make sure I leverage everything I know before I get started is 3x plus 3y, right? Three of these plus three of these. Or if you don't do it algebraically, you just say three small ones plus three big ones. That's the sum of the perimeters. Well, what do they give us with line segment AE? They tell us that here, x plus y is 25. One small one plus one big one is 25. So therefore, to get to here, you just multiply by 3. So that means it's 75. And that's why this one alone is sufficient. Now, here's why the world loves C on this one. Is one, that's hard to do. That takes some time to do. People are thinking quickly. And so you look at that and you go, okay, well, I need all three of these and all three of those. That doesn't tell me enough. But then they see the ratio here and they go, oh, I get it. If it adds to 25 and it's a 2-to-3 ratio, then if I'm using this one, here I'll color code it red, that means this is 10, that's 15, which means this is 10, which means this is 10, which means this is 15, which means that's 15. Together, they give you everything you want to know, right? They give you every side, you fill in the whole diagram, but they didn't ask you to fill in the whole diagram. They asked you for something really specific. We'll call this sneaky sufficient. And it's kind of the blueprint that they like to use. This one's sufficient, but it takes a little bit of work. It takes a little bit of, you know, I would say ingenuity, but like you really have to think about it. This one here kind of is the obvious partner. And so people like that when, what's that, Roman? Because they have to, you know, it's critical thing. It's also leveraging assets, Roman, like, is that's what business is about, right? If you need two employees to get a job done, you got to pay two people. I can do it with one employee because I can figure out how to better budget their time and set all that up. Well, then my costs are half of yours, which means I can charge, you know, 10% less than you and make a ton of profit. And so leveraging assets in business is a pretty big deal in business. And so that's why they're like this. It is kind of a business skill. It's weird with triangles because you're not using a ton of triangles day to day in business, but it's that leveraging assets. It's, hey, can I repackage this? Can I rent out this machine when I'm not using it so that it costs me less overnight? Or, you know, I've got an office building. Can I sublease these? It's ways to repackage your assets to get more out of them. And so it actually is a pretty decent, if you buy into it, decent style of conclusion here. So, and Ash, so many of these, actually like your point there. I wouldn't necessarily say it's easy up front, but what happens with hard GMAT problems, they tend not to be bizarre. When you see the right answer, you go, I can't believe I didn't think of that. I can't believe I didn't do that. Because it is that kind of critical thinking. There are very few where it's like, oh, you don't know,
Salmon's theorem of, you know, octagons or something, which is some like bizarre piece of information that you would never have. It's pretty core information, and they just find interesting ways to package it. And this is sort of their blueprint. They know you don't want to spend a ton of time on statement one because statement two partners so nicely with it. And so we'll get there. The big lesson, let me make sure I give you guys the main takeaway on it, is most people go for C on this one, but a couple things can save you is knowing that it's an overly specific question. The sum of the perimeters of the two triangles, to me, that screams, that's a weird question. They're asking for a weird combination, and so therefore, I'm going to leverage assets or die trying. I'm going to spend another 30, 40 seconds on this one leveraging assets because that's what they tend to do. That's, think like the test maker. When they ask for some combination that's overly specific, I'm going to go in and spend a little bit more time on that. The other one, we talked about Biggie a little bit before. I want to draw a little bit of attention to, we're here in Los Angeles, so we got like our West Coast rap. Tupac has a great lyric from way, way back in the day. I guess way back, he's been dead for 20 years. I hate to sound sleazy, but tease me, I don't want it if it's that easy. I hate to sound sleazy, but tease me, I don't want it if it's that easy. Think about that with data sufficiency. If an answer ever comes to you in 30 seconds, maybe you're that good, maybe it's that easy, or maybe it's that, it seems a little too easy. And so you want to kind of look at it and say, okay, I could pick C here, because C is pretty obvious. I think it's probably C. Let me spend 20 seconds leveraging assets or playing devil's advocate to see, can I get another answer? It's that dress for the job you want, not the job you have. A lot of times with data sufficiency, it's pick the data sufficiency answer choice that someone going to the school you want to go to would pick. Will they take the easy way out, or do you think they could find a way to package it together? You know, obviously it takes some practice, and we're going to do more of this on Friday, but it's really a lot of times about how do you spend your time, and if you spend your time going, oh, that was pretty easy, I'm going to spend 20 more seconds trying to package together a little bit more, then at least you've got a fighting shot at it. So, exactly. Now, some of it is practice tests are important. I think you guys can take practice tests through our systems, part of Prep Advisors, and get at least a one free one. Practice tests to know your own pacing. Like, some people don't have the luxury of time, and you need to figure out how to get a little faster on the stuff you're good at so you have more time for these. So it's all part of a whole puzzle. But I think very often with these, it's fun when I watch the poll from pointing behind the camera, because that's where the poll is for me right now. It's people that do it in 20 or 30 seconds almost always pick the trap. And then you get to see if they stay with it 30 seconds later, they'll change it sometimes. But very often these are set up. You got to look at these graphs. Most of the ones we've done too, one popular trap answer, one similarly popular but less so right answer, they're designed to funnel people toward a trap in many cases. So be aware of that. So, few things to take away from quant, and then I want to do a little bit of an intro to verbal, and we've got 90 minutes kind of budgeted for this. We may go like 10 minutes over if that's cool with you guys. Knowledge is important. I don't want to undervalue that, but reasoning is so important on these. So many times, it's not that you didn't know the content, it's that you rushed to a trap answer or you didn't think critically, you didn't unpack all of your information, so that's important. And that's where this is important to recognize. Know why you're getting problems wrong. If you're getting them wrong because you just don't know enough about triangles, study triangles. Like, I never would have thought to use that rule, or I didn't know how to calculate the area of a rhombus or something like that. But if not, if it's, yeah, I just fell for a trap, I don't know why I didn't see that one, then don't worry about obscure math. People are out there Googling really strong, really strange formulas, and they're not practicing. And Roman, how do you develop reasoning? A lot of it's practice, and it's keep in mind some of these themes we're talking about here, because now that you know, trap answers tend to come from, I didn't play devil's advocate, I didn't look for the strange answer, or I didn't leverage assets well enough. Then when you make those mistakes, you can go back and you go, yeah, I should have leveraged assets. Here was the clue, overly specific statement. statement, or the backstory told me it was only integers need apply. I should have leveraged assets a little bit more there, something like that. Some of it's just having it pointed out to you that, hey, these are the things that are out there, but then practice with all that. Problem solving, we talked about answers or assets. Data sufficiency, we kind of grandstanded for quite a while on these. Keep those in mind, and we're going to come back to these on Friday as well. So there's some homework to play around with, and then Friday we'll really dive in that much more. So I want to spend at least 15 minutes on verbal. You guys are going to do an on-demand video lesson of sentence correction, but I want to set that one up because, like data sufficiency, I think it's the type of problem here. This is about a third of the problems on the verbal section are sentence correction. It's the type of problem that people tend to study for wrong. And so I want to point that out. Let me just throw this sentence up here. And if you guys have any comments, let me know. I'll stand up here for 15 seconds or so. This comes from the official guide for GMAT. Review. It's part of an official problem. What do you guys think? So we got one saying it's correct. I always love the answers. I don't want to do too much coaching. And we've got some people saying nothing at all, which I actually kind of like. It's like, what am I, is anybody sitting there thinking, what am I supposed to be doing? So we've got a couple say it's correct. Kim says no. Is anybody sitting there like, I don't really even get the activity? Somebody doesn't like although. Couple of issues. Awesome. Now, the reason I'm not going to say too much on this isn't how you do sentence correction. This is a lot more like how you do sentence correction. They're going to underline parts of it, and they're going to talk about how you can replace it. So now if we're looking, this is exactly what we had before. Here's number one, here's number two. Which one's right now? One or two, it is someone, it refers to someone. Yeah, now the twos. Guys, and I love that, I don't know, and neither do I. Once you get to this, the twos are pretty well unanimous, right? And it's because it is or it refers to. That's the only decision they're letting us make. I saw a couple of people say, there's a couple errors, or I don't like although, or certain people hate this comma over here sometimes. You don't get to change all that. It is someone or it refers to someone. Well, what is it? It is the term. The term isn't the person, it refers to the person. Right? And so if you didn't see that with this first one here, if I saw this sentence in my brother's term paper, I don't think I wouldn't have a problem with it. But once they point out that distinction, I go, ooh, wait a second. Here, actually, yeah, two is clearer because it gets the pronoun right. One's not. And so if you were, nice, yeah, the psychopath is the person would be kind of bizarre. And so if you're looking at this, it's got to be two, which brings up this. Your job is not to become a newspaper editor. And most people study like it is. Most people are out there just studying all kinds of ridiculous rules of grammar. Yeah, two is correct and one's wrong. Most people are studying obscure grammar over and over again. Whereas in this case, really it is about decision points and decision making. And so think about when you go through these, before you even start reading the sentence, then look at the kind of scan the answer choices between them. We'll see one in a second that's got the five answer choices and look for obvious decisions. Hey, what are they asking me to decide? It's funny watching people do these sometimes because they're criticizing stuff that's not underlined. The underline is the only thing you can change, and then the answer choices give you different ways of doing it. People start editing all kinds of things that they don't even get to change. And so one, scan the answer choices. What are the obvious decisions? So one is find them. That's terrible. I was going to say find decision points. And then two is prioritize. And it's really, what are you good at? So your strengths. And I like to talk to students about, there are others, you guys are going to see a whole lesson in on demand in a few days, but modifiers, verbs, and pronouns you can get really good at. You can get good at, what does the pronoun refer to? Is it singular, they plural, it's singular, they're plural? verbs? Is it the right verb tense? Does the subject agree with the verb? On modifiers, does this description, does it logically describe what it's supposed to be describing? And Francois, totally agree. They guide you to the decisions, then do them in your order. Know what you're good at. Some of them are modifiers, verbs, pronouns. There's parallelism in a series, some other things. But your goal really is to get good at modifiers, verbs, pronouns, couple other things. Find the decision points and then do them on your terms. The other thing people screw up a lot is they just start deciding on stuff they're not great at. And technically, it's supposed to be done in like 6 minutes. It'll probably be 10, if that's okay, Elizabeth. So, it's recorded. So, if anybody's at work and has to go or something, feel free. So find the decision. What are they asking you to decide between? Prioritize the decisions you're good at, and then you don't have to become a master of grammar. You can just kind of know the stuff you're supposed to know really well, and you guys will do that that lesson on demand here and see all the major categories you need to do well at, and then get really good at those. So, and Roman, good question. It depends on who you are. If you read in the English language a lot, you can get by. I get by on a lot of it too. I've gotten good at grammar because I have to teach it, but when I'm taking the test, I'm doing it on I know a handful of things. I know what these are. No problem. Don't worry about it. For most people, it's systematic. So I would say there are people who are just such good readers, such avid readers, know the language well, good writers, that they don't need a ton of strategy because they just know it. For the vast majority of us, we need to have a system. And it's find the decisions, prioritize the ones you're good at, use good process of elimination, and then you avoid decisions you're not great at making. And so with that in mind, this is probably my all-time favorite sentence correction problem that I want to see if you guys can attack here. Same thing, I'm going to run over and start up the poll, clear it out, start the timer, attack this one, and there's a couple great lessons we can learn here. We'll probably finish up on this one, and then we'll get you guys more of this in a couple weeks, or a couple days. So attack this, timer is going on. All right, these statistics are beautiful. Thank you guys for all the participation. We are almost unanimous here about answer choice C. What does that tell you? You guys know me by now. If everyone's picking C, it ain't C. Exactly, because we're going to learn from that. I love this question because you can even see the world does it too. It's the world's between A and C on this one. And nice. Okay, and actually, everybody take a look and see what he just typed there, because that's brilliant. Even if you didn't know that it was brilliant, it's a lot of times on these, you won't like the answer you pick, but you know for sure the other four are wrong. And so that's what a lot of sentence correction is. Let me talk about actually for a second. You know how they write these? They find interesting sentences in the New York Times and the Economist. Those are the two most common ones they pick sentences from. So they go out and they find interesting sentences from the New York Times and the Economist, and they're strange. They're interestingly structured. That's their right answer, and then they tweak the sentence for wrong answers and leave fatal flaws in them, right? So here's the way this one works. They know that you read from left to right and from top to bottom, right? So what do? They give you something you don't love in A, right? So dense and convoluted as to pose. How many people out there are thinking, I prefer so dense that they pose, right? So X, that Y is true. It's so hot outside that I turned on the air conditioning. I'm so hungry that I could even eat at Wendy's or whatever it may be. It's kind of, it's so this, that happens. Everybody speaks that way. People love that structure. That doesn't mean that this one's wrong. So if you go left to right, top to bottom, you pick C, because it fixes something that wasn't really broken there. All right. What Ash mentioned up at the beginning is we've got verb tenses. That's what I mentioned before. Look at obvious decisions. Pose, posed, posed, pose, pose. This is an obvious decision, and like I said before, you're gonna be good at modifiers, verbs, and pronouns are a couple of the things you're gonna get really good at. Verbs are decisions you wanna prioritize because you can get really good at them. Let's look at what's going on in the sentence. Kant's writings are characterized currently by sentences so dense and convoluted as to pose a significant hurdle for many readers who study currently his works. So, is it logical to say we characterize his sentences this way because they used to pose a hurdle for people who are currently studying his works? The verb is dead wrong here. It's not even a preference thing, it's just illogical that you would never say, we characterize his writings this way because they used to pose a challenge for people who currently study his works. These are just wrong, and that leaves you with A and E. So even though you'd prefer so dense and convoluted that, you don't get to because that's gone. So dense and convoluted as to pose is right. Dense and convoluted enough as they pose. If it were dense and convoluted enough that they pose, maybe, because it's a critical mass of this leading to that. As they pose, I don't even look at it. Is it they're dense and convoluted while they pose? Like, as I was walking to work, I witnessed a car accident or something means while. It's just not a direct, clear sentence. And so the answer is A. But what's interesting with how people do it is exactly that. They read left to right, top to bottom. They bait you into making a decision here that you're not good at. And so one thing we like to call this is the corrupt mechanic. Anybody ever take your car in for service, and what does a corrupt mechanic do? You take it in for an oil change, you take it in to get your tires rotated, and they say, hey, by the way, you need a new valve for this portion of the engine. They fix something that wasn't broken and charge you for it, and just figure either you're in too much of a hurry, like you are here, or you're not knowledgeable enough, like maybe you are here, to notice that it wasn't broken. And so it's the corrupt mechanic. That's what the test maker loves to do. They find a sentence that's interesting. To Akshay's point, I didn't like it, but I knew the others were dead wrong. That's going to be your strategy on a lot of these, because they pick sentences that are just unique enough that it's not in the way you would write it, but you can't find a fatal flaw. You want to prioritize the stuff you know you're good at. So, nice. All right, perfect, guys. It's at least you got to that point, right? If you didn't make the mistake that the world makes over and over again, you're in better shape, and the jitters will get you. Some of it is, there's a little bit of, I don't say intuition, but a little bit of, I just know that's right, or I know that's like, every once in a while you're down between the last two and it's harder to verbalize, but what tends to happen is the trap answer is something that people know why they liked it, and they just miss something obvious there. At a certain point when you start teaching this stuff, every one of our instructors has gone through the same thing. We're like a year or two in, there's a student that knows so much weird grammar, you almost feel like a fraud. You're like, I don't know what to tell you about that. And then you realize, you shouldn't be considering that. Like, I eliminated that answer 10 minutes ago because the verb tense was wrong or the pronoun was wrong. And so it's a lot of times people are splitting hairs on the wrong answer anyway. So the big theme is prioritize the decisions you're good at. Look what's obvious and then prioritize those decisions. And yeah, fire away, Ash. I've gotten a little bit ambitious here. Oops. And added one more on here. I don't think we'll have time for it because I don't hold people too long. But here's some major takeaways here. I guess it's two questions there, Ash. A, there's just no flaw, right? So there's just the sentence, the structure is right. One of the things I love, Chris, this guy who co-wrote all of our lessons, he always likes to say, he's like, I became a really good writer by doing a lot of official sentence correction problems, using good strategy and seeing which one's left and going, oh, that's an interesting sentence structure. Seeing it in the New York Times a couple times and then starting to write that way. And people are like, wow, you write really well. He's like, I'm just stealing sentence structures from good. So it's right. There's no one thing that makes it right. It's really the absence of error. He's got a couple issues with it. It's, like I said, that as could mean while, so it's just unclear. And there's also, so if it's dense and convoluted enough as they pose, then it's, okay, are they dense and convoluted while they're posing? Doesn't seem to be as direct of a sentence or as like clear of a meaning, could be that they pose, could be as they pose, could be that critical mass or another. And then that enough is a little bit tricky in comparison here because it makes it seem that there's some threshold. This one's so dense and convoluted, it's overall, they're so dense, so convoluted. Whereas it's almost like enough is like, oh, that's enough gas in the car, that's enough food for me today. It makes it seem like there's one threshold you have to get over. So it's a little bit awkward that way. So there are a few flaws in E. I agree, it's a slightly tougher. Oh, no worry, Bernice, we'll see you on Wednesday. Slightly tougher distinction than I'm probably making it here, but nice, perfect. Yeah, there are a few there where it's like I'm a little uncomfortable with it. This one is just like what makes this one right is it came from the New York Times, so they find their interesting structures in the wild somewhere, and that's kind of how it gets done. So bear in mind this: you want to prioritize the decisions you're good at. We'll kind of borrow from America's most popular pre-Trump president of all time, his book Decision Points. Decision points are big. Just know what you're deciding on and then do them in your order. They love to bait you into decisions you're not qualified to make. You're just, you're not a grammar expert, a newspaper editor, or something like that. So the best tool you have at your disposal is, I'm going to do it in my order. I'm going to look for errors I'm 100% confident in spotting and eliminating. And then if I'm down between two, then I'll start to split hairs on something that, this feels right or wrong. But you'll always get rid of two or three on something very concrete. It just may not be the first decision it looks like they're having you make. So if we wrap up for now, because I got a little ambitious. I love that question that's there. But a couple things to keep in mind. Your homework is all at this link, which I think you guys have. It's also in your email, so you won't be able to click on this on your screen. But we're going to go through several more lessons together. So we'll wrap up for today. I'll hang out for questions and things. If anybody's interested in longer amounts of time with us or going through the whole on-demand program or anything like that, we'll have this offer up all week and everything, so keep in mind there. You can learn more about our classes. There will be homework for all these, so keep that in mind. We'll be answering questions in the forums and everything there. Big wrap-up things for today. It's a reasoning test, so it's not just about the skills. You need to know what do you do and what do you watch out for. Oops, that's terrible. You guys can read that. We're going to continue to hit those themes throughout the week in the video lesson you guys get, in the solutions to your practice test questions and everything. But keep all that in mind. Hopefully you guys got, there are strategies that you'll want to keep in mind as you go through all these problems. It's a lot more of a reasoning, playing the game, kind of prioritizing your strengths and all those kind of things than it is just pure knowledge. So hopefully you guys got that out of today. We're going to continue to build on that. All your homework and stuff will be posted here, and then I'll see you guys on... Oh yeah, the planning of the week. So today was this. Wednesday is critical reasoning, another verbal question type. And then Friday is data sufficiency. You also have access to, and I forget where it falls on the syllabus, they may have a specific day for you guys to do it. I'll check online. Yep, same time. You have the on-demand version of the sentence correction lesson. So it's myself and my colleague Lisette teaching that one. You guys can watch that whenever you want. And then all your homework and the syllabus and everything is posted here. So. Yeah, this was fun. Seriously, thank you guys for so much participation, for fighting through a little bit. I know every once in a while the tech is a little bit tricky, so hopefully you guys got. Roman, good question. I think they post all these to YouTube, so there'll be more information at the link here. I know my job is to send the recording off to a Dropbox somewhere, and then we'll see where it goes. But I think this link will have more information about where you can access everything. So rather me say that than say something specific and out of there. So. Awesome. Thank you, guys. No, this was fun. So, yeah, come back. This level of energy makes it so much. But it was first activity in the morning for me, so I'm amped for the rest of the day. So, actually, go through here, and I'm going to check this. I'll have more information for Wednesday. I should have flipped through there before, but I'll just keep pointing to that one so I don't direct you guys astray. I need a teleprompter with somebody giving me more answers here. So, awesome. Well, thanks, everybody. I'm going to step off and get the recording going. I'll be on chat for a little bit while that's going on. So if you guys have any questions or anything, drop them there. Drop them in the forum. I'll be browsing that all week and all next week and everything, too. So thanks, everybody. Enjoy the rest of your Monday, and we'll see you back here same time on Wednesday. Thanks.